first met Jim, all he said to me, he wanted to make a film about love. And really, it was about two people, two creatures, who were pure spirits. And they were yin and yang, they were black and white, they were the sun and the moon, and that they were very rare, sensitive, delicate beings who were alive to the gift of human creativity, to the gift of life, really. They were so sensitive to the things that we've been given, things that nature and poetry and music and science and philosophy and literature and love, ultimately. And the twist was that these two creatures were vampires. And I thought it was just the most amazing inversion of a very popular concept, that somehow in our contemporary culture, vampires are everywhere. When I first met Jim, he said, "Tom, Adam is basically Hamlet as played by Syd Barrett." And I thought that was one of the greatest descriptions of a character that I'd ever heard. And I understood it immediately, is that he is a melancholy, sad, poetic, sensitive soul inside the body of a rock star. He was turned into a vampire around the late 16th century, early 17th century. We decided, so he lived through the Romantic era, and in a way he is a kind of contemporary rock star with the soul of a Romantic poet. For the last 500 years, Adam has been part of a movement in the progression of music and science. That's where his heart is. But he's also a vampire, so the normal things apply. They've been incarnations of our sublimated desires, you know. They've been sort of embodiments of our sexuality, of our sort of feral animalism. That they're as, because you know that vampires are the living dead. They're closer to wolves and bats and beasts than humans, and they live off blood, and they have fangs. You know, there's all of these things. And Jim was taking something that was very popular and making it his own, and making these vampires, Adam and Eve, he was basically making them artists. Adam has a special deal with the local hospital, where he gets, you know, clean, pure, O-negative, type O-negative blood. And he smuggles it into into his life. So he did, precisely because he doesn't want to destroy people, he doesn't want to kill or to bite. Yeah, I've been saying to my family, he's like a vegetarian vampire. The question one has to ask oneself as an actor in this role is, what would it be like to live forever? What would it be like to be immortal? And for many, many, many people, that would be a blessing, because as human beings on this planet, we all run out of time. We all do, we all die. And we all die, I'm sure, with a long list of things that we never did. And Adam and Eve don't have that problem. They have lived forever. They will live forever. Vampires are eternal. And I think for Eve, I can't speak for Tilda, but I hope that she would say this, is that her immortality is a blessing. And it's given her the gift of seeing everything. For Adam, there is a part of immortality as a vampire that is a curse, because Adam has a predisposition to melancholia, to sadness, to depression. And for Adam, I think, the most destructive aspects of human beings breaks his heart. The fact that human beings destroy things and that they destroy each other, that they fight wars, that they are capable of prejudice and racism or hatred or separatism of any kind, the fragility of existence gives him such pain. Eve asks Adam, she says, "Why do you live in Detroit?" And Adam says, "For me, Detroit is like watching time-lapse photography. Time-lapse photography of a beautiful flower that grows from a seed and opens into an exquisite blossom. It's majestic in its perfection. And then the flower starts to close. It shrivels and fades. Its stem and leaves turn brown and dry, and then it crumbles to dust in a single century." That's Detroit for him, is this flower that comes into blossom and then fades and dies. And because Adam is who he is, because he's Hamlet as played by Syd Barrett, because he's trying to channel his melancholic soul into his music and in his work, because he's such an intelligent, sensitive person, that to him is so beautiful, to live in a city that is an example of the fragility of life. If you were a vampire living in the present, in this present day, you're someone who don't want to be found out. You don't want to be discovered. So where do you live? Well, Adam chooses to live in Detroit because probably nobody's going to look for him there. Ian is Adam's manager. Adam's doing this thing where he wants to release his music underground, but he doesn't want any credit for it. He doesn't want any fame or any money. He's absolutely not interested in fame, money, any of that stuff. He just wants to know what people think. And Ian is his mirror. And Ian just thinks Adam is the best thing since sliced bread. Ian kind of hero worships Adam in a way, because Adam represents everything that Ian loves about rock and roll, you know, about Detroit, because Adam is just so cool, you know. He loves music for the sake of music. He doesn't want money, he doesn't want fame. He's indie, he's reclusive, you know. He looks how he looks. He's got long black hair and he's very skinny and pale, and he looks like Syd Barrett, you know. So they need each other. You know, Ian needs Adam because Adam reminds him of what's beautiful about music and Detroit. And Adam needs Ian because, you know, he can't go out to guitar shops in the daytime. He'll be burnt by the sun. The trouble comes when Eve's sister, Ava, turns up. She's an old school vampire. She bites, she turns. She's hungry and capricious. She's unpredictable and impetuous and stubborn and willful and manipulative. And it's all. And Adam gets very, very worried about her being around because she throws the sort of precarious equilibrium that they've established completely out of balance. So that suddenly Ava's arrival is very, very worrying for Adam. I find Jim incredibly poetic. And it's been a long time since I've met someone like him. I don't think I've ever met anyone like him, actually, because he has such a depth of knowledge and experience about so many things. He's so intelligent and so passionate and sensitive about about things. And in a way, you know, this whole film, everything I've been talking about, the idea about the fragility of being alive, the primacy of love, the fragility and the delicacy of artistic endeavor or scientific curiosity or musical skill, you know, these are all things that have come out of Jim's head and his heart. And as a director, he's incredibly collaborative, because he wants to know what I think. He wants to know what Tilda thinks, and Mia, and Anton. He directs like a poet to me. He's a poet. A poet of cinema and music together. I mean, music is so much sewed into the DNA of cinema anyway. But he's very, very clear about creating pictures, and the picture in all of its detail and subtlety will tell you everything you need to know. And it's been brilliant for me, because under the skin of Adam, I've been able to do some very, very, I hope, very, very small and subtle things that he sees. He's never trying to demonstrate or telegraph or explain things to the audience. He's just presenting a world. He's presenting characters who inhabit a particular space. And he and we have done a huge amount of work on who those characters are and what that space looks like. But he's never going to ram it. He's never going to force you to see anything. He's just going to present it to you. And then it's up to you. And that, to me, is the work of a true artist, someone who is presenting a view of the world. Adam and Eve remind each other that the only reason for living is for love. And even in the course of that belief is tested by the fact that then life becomes endangered. So we have two people who live off blood, and their blood supply runs out. So they have to survive together, and they have to learn how to survive. And I hope that the reason that they can, the reason that they are left alive, is because they are lovers. So only lovers left alive is a summation for me of the primacy of true love, in a way.